Last two questions. Lady over here.
I've been told that women in Islam wear a veil because in this way men will treat them respectfully. But I see the veil as a form of oppression, because why should they have to cover themselves because of the weakness of men? Shouldn't they be treated with respect regardless? Could you please explain the veil, and did Mary have to wear a veil?
Madam, your Bible says, your holy Bible says, you know, Paul is telling you that the woman must cover her head, that the woman who doesn't cover, shave off her head. Your Bible says that. The woman who bathes her hair says, shave them off. Shave it off. That's what the Bible says. And you woman, your Bible says, she must not be allowed to open her mouth in the church. But that's your churches, they don't believe all that. And your people don't believe in that. So you are inviting trouble. You know, because of this, in America, in New York, no woman is safe after dark. No woman is safe in France. During daytime, women have been raped in the street, and people just walk by, looking for fun. Say, well, maybe they're enjoying themselves. Woman is being raped. No. I said, you are inviting it. Look, this modesty, the nuns, you know, the nuns, Roman Catholic Church, nobody gives them a second look. If Mary, the mother of Jesus, came along, you won't give her a second look. But my dear sisters, those women on your Gold Coast at Scarborough and all that with bikinis and tangas and G-strings, look, sure. It's attracting even an old man like me, I think. If I went there, I tell you, I'll be burning inside. I'm telling you, look, this is the nature of man. God made us like that. The thing that allures man more than anything on earthly existence is woman. Do you know that? I don't know. The Quran says, ذُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ حُبُّ الشَّهْوَاتِ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ. Fear in the sight of men is the love of things they covet. Number one, مِنَ النِّسَاءِ, women. وَالْبَنِينَ, then son. You know, I've got 11 sons. I can make my own football team. You know how you know, it makes me feel proud. I've got 11 sons, you know. My own football team, my own cricket team. والبنين, and number three, والقناطير المكنترة من الذهب والفضة, and hoarded heaps of gold and silver, and wealthy land, and horses branded for excellence, and all this. This is a list that is given in the Quran. Number one, women. The Quran says, the thing that allures man most on this earthly existence is woman. And I'm telling my Western friends that I don't have to prove that to you. I don't have to convince you. I said, you see, in my country, in the city of Durban, I think we'll end with this. Okay? We'll end with this. In the city of Durban, there is a firm called Lucien Motors. They sell second-hand trucks. You know, lorries, trucks. We call them trucks here too. And on the trucks that they advertise, there's a woman in the bikini on top of the truck. Then G Knots, they sell farm implements. And on the tractors that they advertise, there's a woman in the bikini on top of the tractor. I'm asking these Westerners, I said, what has a woman in the bikini got to do with a second-hand truck or with a tractor? Except the man. You see, the woman is being dangled, so it's the Edwards. And BMW, I don't know if you have BMWs here. It's a motor car supposed to be a little better than the Mercedes-Benz. I'm not in the market for it. You see, I started with the Volkswagen Beetle. I did 120,000 miles, and I had to change for another Beetle, and another Beetle, and another Beetle. Then they stopped making the Beetle. You know the Volkswagen Beetle. They started the Golf, so I had to buy Golf number one, Golf number two. I'm still not in the market for a BMW. But I am forced to read this advert. In my newspaper, I see a BMW motor car. And with the woman, in the skimpiest of bikini, what you call the tanga, you know, the G-string. She's standing in front of the motor car, and it's written at the bottom, test drive her now. I'm asking the woman of the car. The woman is buying the car. And her is underlined. Test drive her now. I said, look, this is what you're leading yourself to. This is the Westerner. He sells his mother, his wife, his daughter. His wife is a star. And she's being mangled on the screen, simulating rape. And they enjoy it. Do you enjoy your wife being simulated? It's not real rape. But you know, it's simulated. You can see everything about it. She's being raped, your mother, your wife, your daughter. And you enjoy your wife as a star. Sick. No, alhamdulillah, praise be to God. We haven't come through that sickness yet, we Muslims. We try to keep away from it. This is your pleasure, your privilege. We have no right to force you. But we say, you are playing with fire, my child, and you're going to pay the price. You're paying the price now, and you will pay the price.
The Uyghurs based on their belief and their religion, which is Islam.
It's outrageous. We need to stand up. You don't need to be Muslim to stand up against this. You just need to be human. It's very sad. It's very sad the way the British government isn't talking about it enough. The media's not talking about it. So we need to stand here today and raise our voices and stop being silent about these persecutions that are happening around the world.
So raising awareness is a staple part of being able to make some kind of a change, because everything starts with knowing what the problem is. You can't have prescriptive measures unless you have diagnostic ones. And we are at this stage trying to diagnose a problem and spread it to the populations in the West and in the East and in the whole world, so people can know what this is that's happening in these regions and how we can change it. We think it's abominable that this is happening without a proper response from Western governments, peoples, organizations.
Allahu Akbar.
ذكر رحمة ربك عبده زكريا إذ نادى ربه نداء خفيا قال رب إني وهن العظم مني واشتعل الرأس شيبا